The movie guys love movies. Any kind.
Stories about what happened.
It's true. All of it. The dark side. The Jedi.
Into Tosche Station to pick up some power converters.
You had to wait for it, but it paid off.
Bart was actually getting goosebumps.
Yes,
yeah, the hair is still
literally
standing.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
So great. Oh. Wow. As well you should.
It is exciting. John Williams.
Oh my God.
That's half that trailer.
Wow.
You know, I saw the trailer on the Monday Night Football, and I think J.J. Abrams is breaking some new ground because I saw zero lens flare. Yeah, he's really stretching here.
I love you because you bring everybody down to a thing, and you rail
the John Woo rule. You cannot be surprised by the number of pigeons in doves in a John Woo movie. So
just like Prince, you cannot be surprised if he wears purple.
Or heels.
Yeah,
or
right?
Heels.
Or heels.
It's just how it is.
I did not listen to that.
No, Adam is going cold turkey.
But I got to tell you, part of the great thing about this, I've never had an experience quite like this. Of course, I've never had an experience quite like this for Star Wars as a right. gigantic Star Wars fan. It's the greatest thing in the world in my life. And so here's this other one that was never going to happen. It's crazy. Just crazy. But I have not been watching the trailers, and it took me a long time to watch the second one. And I only saw it because I was in IMAX 3D before the Avengers. I was like, well, I'm already going nuts.
Right.
You know, let's watch this sucker. And yeah, and that paid off. I mean, you know, Chewbacca and Han Solo at the end or whatever. But the thing that I missed, and I did hear the crash. Paul informed me that this crash was from the trailer, the Star Wars crash. It wasn't
The crash was from the teaser, but that was cue for you to get off because following that was new footage, trailer footage.
Yeah.
And I'm going cool turkey, which means I'm not going to read 10 things we learned about the Star Wars trailer from WeAreGeeks.net or whatever.
That is the worst mistake.
Yeah. So, but I have watched the trailer and, but I'm not going to overwatch it. And I'm certainly going to soak myself into learning everything there is to know before I go in.
But the exciting thing was, there's this atmosphere. This movie is so powerful. There's an atmosphere out there that then the same thing when the last trailer came out. You could feel that people were happier in the street. You could just feel off of people that they all seen the trailer.
It's Christmas morning.
It was Christmas morning. Yeah. And watching you, all your faces, because I took my headphones off and plugged my ears, watching you all react to it is awesome.
Yeah.
I'm loving not seeing the trailer because you got goosebumps.
It was like when LeBron went back to Cleveland. I literally called my sister and said, I don't know why, but my life is better right now. Things are just better
this
now.
This is a good week. Bill Murray has a Bill Murray movie coming out.
Oh,
yeah,
oh my God,
life is better.
Yeah. I know, right?
I couldn't
solid
explain
week.
Why.
Round the table, there's happiness.
Yes. I know. You know, but just like with Phantom Menace, even though we didn't know how not that great that movie was going to be, but still, Jedis, come on. But the months before that, you got to be real careful while crossing the street. You know, you're like, I do not. I just want to make sure I'm...
Paul already... I came home from work the other day, and I said, Paul, what have you been doing all day? And on the phone, he was kind of scared. He was kind of cagey, so I knew he was up to something. So I was called. I'm like, hey, did you get stuff done? He's like, oh, I've been real busy. I just got going here at 5. I'm like, oh, okay. I come home. He's on the phone telling someone, all right, I got the tickets. He spent all afternoon.
Didn't. I lucked out because me and my friend Wayne were coming at him from two angles trying to get on that internet where Fandango and Arclight and Regal and AMC theaters all crashed.
Yeah.
They're predicting a $600 million opening weekend, which is as much as Titanic made in its entire run.
Yeah. Jeez.
I mean,
welcome to the Movie Showcast, everybody. Part of the vast and sprawling Movie Guys empire, and you just watch yourself. We're wanted men. We have a death sentence on 12 systems.
Oh, be careful.
You've reached ground zero for all you'll be dead. You've reached ground zero for all things movies and comedy. We bring the two together right here on our show every week with jokes, rants, sketches, characters, ugnots, banter, bits, special guests, and more as we broadcast from the Admiral's Club in the heart of Burbank Airport's flyover zone. They don't stop making movies, so we don't stop making comedy shows about movies, which means you can get a new show every week at themovieguys.net or iTunes, SoundCloud, Stitcher, Vimeo, YouTube. There's many options.
A lot of internet.
What we're trying to say.
A lot of internet going on.
We're out there. And where you find us, please subscribe, review positively, you know, like and share posts. Still, no charge. We're also on WBAD.net for free. Fridays at 4 p.m. Eastern, 1 p.m. Pacific. Basically, just search The Movie Guys or The Movie Showcast on Yahoo, Google, or...
Bing!
And we come right up. I'm your host for the hardest working comedy show on the airwaves, Paul Preston, here with Karen Volpe.
Ninja!
Bart Caius.
Say, brainless, don't you know where coconuts come from?
And Adam Witt.
Right now, I feel like I could take on the whole empire myself.
In the second half of the show, we'll be joined by a film producer who has made his directorial debut with the documentary available now, streaming on Netflix, as well as Amazon and Microsoft Movies, and also still screening across the country. Mm-hmm. Go to wreckingcrew.tv for screening dates, because it's popping up here and there, and you can go check it out. Denny Tedesco.
Yay!
We've already chatted him up. This is going to be a lot of fun. As ever, we're here to fill you in on what's new at the theater, so that'll be first. As it's a big weekend with some Halloween efforts getting an early jump on the holiday, such as The Last Witch Hunter and Paranormal Activity, The Ghost Dimension. Mm. Yeah. Not for nothing, and I should tell this to Denny, The Ghost Dimension is my favorite Motown group. Also opening, and perhaps even scarier, Gem and the Holograms.
That is scary.
About a teenage girl who has a video of her secretly posted to the internet.
Hot!
Relax, Bart. She was singing.
Oh.
And she becomes an overnight pop sensation.
Of course she does.
And Karen, later in the show.
Oh, yes!
Oh, boy.
I am Richie Lanz. It's a real pleasure. Time for a crazy story. I was a rock tour manager, and this is what I'm supposed to do. I'm supposed to tour with my act.
To Afghanistan?
Yes, it's a coming together of our two favorite things.
Star Wars. Nothing but Star Wars. Give me the Star Wars.
Now I'm getting goosebumps.
Of course you are.
So awesome.
Based on a true story.
With the Richie Lanz?
Or inspired by a true story.
Is that right?
That's, I've seen it on
Shut
the screen.
Shut up. That makes it even better.
Yeah.
Okay.
Now, it's inspired. Remember, so there's...
Right, right.
There's
a guy named Richie somewhere.
There's a gradation here. It's not a true story.
So is JFK.
Yes. Inspired by actual events. A
well,
man named Richie.
It can't be actual events because a girl from Afghanistan gets out. So
wasn't there one of them in a show? They made a movie.
We already did that once.
It took place in Indianapolis. It was like Afghanistan to him.
All right, let's get on our first,
foist movie.
Our first film of the busy weekend is The Last Witch Hunter.
Oh, hey, honey, better order more witch hunters. We're down to our last one. Hey, which one of you ate all the witch hunters?
From Keebler.
Well, Adam, since you spoke up, you'll be talking about it with me. Here we go. Witches.
Denny, that's my brother, by the way.
Oh, Denny back in the green room listening to this music. That's Karen's brother's band.
And what's the name of the band, Karen? Tell him.
Sweet Ass Cream Corn. They're from Buffalo.
Nice.
Witches just can't catch a break in cinema. Or Massachusetts, for that matter.
Yes, the latest attempt to make witches as fun and interesting and as profitable as vampires stars Vin Diesel, the name that tries too hard.
According to the trailer, the Witch Queen has returned to destroy humanity. Mm. Seems like a good enough excuse for Vin Diesel to kill a bunch of them with a flourish of special effects.
Now, after I read the synopsis for this movie, I felt like I had a pretty good idea what this movie was going to be about. I mean, I watched the trailer, but then I watched the trailer and I have no idea. I don't have the first damn clue. Now, from the title, I'm assuming it's about witches and there is a hunter of them, so I'm going with that. But still, it's not entirely clear if Diesel's playing Abraham Lincoln or not. Anybody catch?
So it's about how... Well, yeah, that adds to it. So it's about how... Even in the modern world, witches still live among us. Mm. And for those of you who watched the most recent Democratic presidential debates, you're already a believer.
Equal time.
Had to do a Democrat, just equal time across the board.
Oh, right, exactly. You got to pick on the Democrats. I get you.
Vin Diesel plays a bad bearded Highlander named Calder, cursed with immortality by the Queen Witch on her deathbed. Mm-hmm. So much like his career, he can't be killed.
We were born to be princes of the universe.
Yeah. It's feeling a little Highlander-y, yeah. Back when he had hair, Calder slayed the Queen Witch and all but brought an end to the plague of witches that terrorized the world, seeking to destroy it. Oh, sure, there was the occasional witch for him to slay here and there, you know, like Raven Simone. But for the most part, Calder has been left to toil in eternity, forever unable to join his wife and son in the afterlife. Well, turns out the Queen Witch has been resurrected.
Well, it just so happens that your friend here is only mostly dead. There's a big difference between mostly dead and all dead.
Well, yes, the Queen Witch was only mostly dead. This spells trouble for Calder, who now has to once again take up arms against the most feared witch of them all.
Ann Coulter?
No, but good guess. And to do this, he has to go to the Dream World. Or something. I don't know. Really, watch the trailer and tell me if you can tell what the hell's going on.
Oh, however will he be taken to the Dream World? Sleep, perhaps?
So, not buying the plot? Well, Michael Caine is on hand to make sure everything sounds plausible. He could explain Trump's economic plan and add 10% to his poll numbers. I didn't research it, but I'm pretty sure Michael Caine's speeches in this trailer are actually just lifted from Batman.
Perhaps whole clips. You don't even have to come in
when
and
it first came
say
in, I was
them
like,
over.
A little confused. Like, I'm like, wait, is this a line from Batman?
Oh, and also, Elijah Wood plays the wide-eyed and bushy-tailed priest, but mostly wide-eyed.
Now, I mentioned to a female friend of mine that there was a new Vin Diesel movie, and she asked, is there a difference between The Rock and Vin Diesel? Now, there is, but that doesn't mean I knew how to explain it to her.
I do wonder.
That is a fair question.
I wonder about this Vin Diesel. Do you think they cast him, then write a script without soliloquies? Or do they see a long speechless script and go, get Diesel?
Get Diesel.
Anyway, here's a clip.
Yeah, you're not qualified for what happens next.
So it begins.
It's a Vietnam movie.
Yes.
You know, that version of Paint It Black makes me yearn for Bill Murray as Nick the Lounge Singer. I'd like to hear his version.
Well, here's this. Star Wars. We got that. All right, listen, after Riddick.
I see a red door.
After Riddick and the Fast and the Furious, Vin Diesel hasn't been cast in a film that he can't turn into a franchise. Hmm. But he faces a challenge with the final sounding The Last Witch Hunter.
Oh, so let's take a minute here and sadly recount the movies we'll presumably never see, such as The Last Witch Hunter Part 2.
Mm-hmm. The Next Witch Hunter.
A Very Witch Hunter Christmas.
And Witch Hunter Port of Call, New Orleans. That's a mouthful. Well, thank God we won't see it. We'll never have to say it again.
Witch Hunter, The Legend of Curly's Gold. Also, you won't get
that
one.
Not gonna happen. Witch Hunter, based on the novel pushed by Sapphire.
So half this movie, he looks like Abraham Lincoln, and the other half, he looks like Bruce Willis.
I didn't realize that was him.
Right?
With the beard and the hair.
I know. He looks
if
like Jean Valjean.
If he wants to go out in public completely incognito, just put any hair on that man's head. Anywhere in his head. Like just one cheek. You have no idea it's Vin Diesel.
Until you go up to him and go, so you're not Vin Diesel? And he goes, yep. That's Vin Diesel.
Bart, I want to tell you that Bart has this, like it's a superhero skill, that when he puts on hair of any kind, he's gorgeous.
Yes, it's a power I rarely use, apparently.
But it's weird because he'll put on hair and then it's just like, holy shit, who's that guy? Vin Diesel doesn't have that
How
power.
How am I not insulted right
now? I doubt. Because you're good looking now, but when you put on hair, it's kind of...
Deadly. It's deadly.
It's a little frightening. Vin Diesel does not have that power.
No, he didn't. He didn't look better or good.
No.
He looked completely different, and I had no idea. The plot looks amazingly confusing to me.
Yeah.
Because he killed the witch. The witch somehow comes back. He has to go into the dreamland. He wants to reunite with his dead wife and son.
Wow, you've put the most importance on the plot of anyone talking about this movie.
Okay. From
the creators.
Am I missing the point here?
Yeah.
Haven't you heard the witch queen has returned?
Boom. There's your movie.
Boom, there's your movie. Ding dong, the witch queen said. Here's my question. Boom, there's your movie. So you won't be able to answer this. So how can you be more dead, right? So he has to kill the witch queen, and she's probably...
Apparently it didn't work last time.
Yeah, it seemed like a very convenient reason to have a movie. We killed her, but she came back.
So we...
Kill
how
her
do you
again?
Extra kill her? Yeah, he's got to put that together
so
first.
You've got to super kill her.
Michael Caine will know. What am I saying?
Oh,
Michael
Caine.
He'll come in with the gravitas. Listen, the thing you have to remember...
My name... Well, how do you do Mike Cocaine?
My cocaine.
Whose cocaine is that, Paul?
My cocaine.
My cocaine.
Oh, okay.
All right, let's get on to our next movie. Our next film is Paranormal Activity, The Ghost Dimension.
Ooh, The Ghost Dimension.
Okay, Bart, calm down. It doesn't star Tom Cruise. That's Ghost.
Are you sure? Oh, I mean, protocol. It could. It is a movie.
No, this is a Blum. This is a Blum.
That's evidence. That's evidence in the positive.
This is a Blumhouse production.
Oh, okay.
Blumhouse productions don't star actors.
Ah, yes.
That's not their thing. But you're in now. Let's talk about it. Here we go.
Could star Tom Cruise. Tom Cruise is in movies.
Activity.
Paul, do you remember that $15,000 movie that made a gazillion dollars a few years ago? Well, it's hard to call it a franchise when they've basically remade the same movie over and over again.
Well, here's this one. After a family starts to experience scary supernatural occurrences in a home they recently moved into, the father of the family, Ryan, must find a way to protect his daughter from these evil spirits before it's too late. Like, move out of the house?
I've lived in the neighborhood for several years, and your house is definitely the most beautiful. But I have to tell you, the previous tenants said sometimes they heard screams coming from the basement.
Okay, we'll just fill it with cement and move out of the house.
And of course, from the Pragmatics.
Still in pre-production, though.
It's still
Pragmatics, yes.
Hold on a second, Paul. Before we go any further, please tell me, do they find footage?
It's a movie, isn't it?
To quote yourself. Yes. The amount of unfound footage reaches new lows as Paranormal Activity releases its fifth movie for the first time in three dimensions. No, four dimensions. It's length, width, height, and ghost.
Thanks to modern advances like tile GPS apps, now you can find anything you've lost. Keys, wallet. Footage?
The found footage is video showing young Kate and Christy being taught supernatural abilities by their grandmother.
Oh, man, all my grandmother ever taught me was how to rinse the corn out of her dentures. Wait, Paul? Who's Katie and Christy?
Well, they're characters from a previous paranormal movies.
And what do I need to know about them?
They're creepy kids.
Oh, okay, gotcha.
It seems like only yesterday that the first Paranormal Activity started a new era in horror movies, but that's only because they seem to release one of these movies every 6 hours.
And I was out of ideas, like I is.
God bless those guys.
But Paranormal Activity 5, let's call it, goes beyond found footage to bring us found camera.
What?
Camera that can see into another dimension and yet still shoots on VHS.
What's the traditional anniversary gift for a fifth movie in a series? Paper? Silver?
Gimmicks, Paul. I think it's gimmicks.
That's right. Paranormal Activity, the movie that set the standard for lack of complexity in photography, has now gone 3D. Every time they look into the VHS home video recorder, they see 3D. I hope they put up the text, "Put your 3D glasses on now," when it happens, to be really old school.
Now, despite the video being recorded over 20 years ago, an operating system still exists that allows the family to watch the video.
Willing suspension of disbelief.
Sure, why not?
Yeah, I can't even get my iPhone to work with my iTunes because I upgraded the operating system.
Things start to get weird when a young girl starts muttering odd phrases.
What are you doing in here?
What is she doing?
Is she talking backwards? Is she saying Bloody Mary?
Well, here at the Movie Guys Labs,
she ordered a Bloody Mary.
She's thirsty.
Very advanced.
I hope they didn't give it to her. Here at the Movie Guys Labs, we've put this clip through our deciphering software, and we're not getting Bloody Mary.
No.
I mean, listen.
Dry ass mildew.
Yeah. Oh, that's a new house. Yeah.
If I heard dry ass, if a kid came up to me and went dry ass mildew, I wouldn't immediately think, what are you saying backwards?
Yeah, you'd be like, someone needs to go and repaint the cupboard or something, the closet.
Dry oatmeal.
It happens with new construction in homes.
You get mildew. Mildew. Sure.
She's trying to warn
him. Perfectly explainable.
And then she comes over, she's like, lead paint.
So, in the face of impending evil, what does the father do?
We gotta find more of those tapes.
Okay. Well, Dad's just full of good ideas, isn't he?
What's the twist this time? The kids go back in time and become parents to themselves? Or maybe they were alive the whole time?
Now, once again, a trailer for a scary movie returns to yell at me. Every 10 seconds, somebody gets paranoid and then a bunch of jump cuts and a scream. But luckily, it's been put to good use as the United Nations has cleared showing Paranormal Activity, Ghost Dimension, trailer to the members of ISIS during interrogation.
Oh, yeah.
And you know what, Paul? We're already getting some good useful intel.
Oh, I believe it. Do they have the old Clockwork Orange on the eyes?
Yeah.
And the headphones?
It does scream at you every 2 seconds, this trailer.
Did you notice that the found footage is VHS? Because even ghosts are like, screw beta.
Yeah.
No.
It was dealt a laser disc.
Dealt with that shit when I was alive.
Ghosts love laser disc.
No.
I mean, it's so great because they open up a box of the VHS tapes and each one of them has like a big label of like, you know, vacation or whatever, or something, each name. It'd be so great if like, because everybody on VHS, you had to record all 6 hours, so you'd record Blues Brothers, but then you'd also put the Cotton Club and you put a couple other things on the on the other, you know,
and
4 hours.
And Daryl. Put Daryl.
It'd be so great if it was like, you know, Vanity Legation and Daryl.
All right, I don't know if you guys did this, but Paul Preston, it's so cute. He would put a couple of different movies on his tape, and what he would do is on the spine, because it's not good enough to just write the name, he would get that publisher clearinghouse whenever they would send you the videos.
That's
and
clever.
They would have the stickers that you would lick and put on the thing that you wanted to order. Paul would
lick
not
him,
order.
Stick them on the spine.
He would stick them on the spine. So he'd have Ghostbusters, Blues Brothers, Caddyshack, licked and on the spine.
You're welcome, America.
That's so smart. But that is a great interview question we always often ask for our guests. What are the other two movies you had on that?
Right. Yeah,
I had Sarant Lives like crazy, but they were always wedged around a Ghostbusters.
I just reminded Ghostbusters, the other movie on that one, Pretty in Pink.
Oh,
and
yeah,
I think just some music videos.
Stripes for sure.
If you but then if you had three comedies that were 90 minutes, you had an hour.
Yeah.
Then boom, Bobcat Goldthwait stand up special.
Yeah, exactly.
I have that Steve Martin television special. It's hard to find where he rides the elephant.
Yeah, well, we have that now, and he put that out on disc. Thankfully.
Yeah.
That's a great one. Comedy, comedy's not pretty.
That. Yeah. Now here's the other thing. You know, when you do musicals and stuff, like in band concerts and stuff in high school, now I'm trying to go back and I'm taking those and putting them and burning them on discs because the tapes are starting to disintegrate.
Yeah.
I am not that old, so I'm just saying, how are these tapes not disintegrating if they're found from like the, when were they made? The early 80s?
They must
be falling apart
too.
They
must have had the Maxell Gold. Remember there was like, it's so funny, back in there, still VHS, but like you could pay it for expensive VHS as well. It had like high Kappa stance or something. It would have like all kinds of weird words that it
This one has really nice packaging. That's what you get. You get the extra packaging.
It's heavier. They were heavier, the ones that were better.
Raiders, Empire, and Metal Storm, The Destruction of Jared Sin were all on a very high quality $20 VHS tape.
Remember those?
I love how you didn't say Raiders of the Lost Ark. You didn't say Empire Strikes Back, but you gave us the full Metal Storm title.
Well, that's one of the most fun titles to say that exists.
Oh,
it's got
awesome.
A colon, but way into it.
Yeah. All right, who's going to this even with MoviePass? Anybody?
I don't think Mueller? I am. I'm behind. I've only seen the first one. And I loved it. But then I got worried that the next ones weren't going to be as good. As effective. That when it was new, I think that was the best way.
So maybe I should pull an Adam and watch them in order and then go see this.
There you go. You're going to ramp up? Hey, we're five in.
Hey, right? You know what? That's interesting because I'm a huge Blumhouse fan, but I've only seen the first one of these.
Oh,
I've not actually seen
you
any
have
others.
Work to do,
you
my
know
friend.
What? That's kind of a good thing for this week. I like this. And I still haven't seen Sinister 2. Maybe I'll go see both of those.
Well, there you go.
Also
the ghost dimension must be horror. I mean, when ghosts cross over into our world in these horror movies, they're always like, in the ghost dimension, is it always just everywhere you go, they're just screaming and yelling?
You should see traffic in the ghost dimension.
I was just going to say the ghost dimension is the 405.
It's a lot like Somalia, I assume.
Yeah.
Remember the opening scene to Captain Phillips?
Yeah.
All those guys did was yell at each other. Everything was horrible.
Yeah.
But you know what's so weird? You'll get a cab driver or something that's maybe Somali or something like that, or you know, from some far off place. And some of the conversations, they're often on the phone, and you think like, oh my God, he's in a terrible fight with his wife,
right.
And that's just how some people talk.
Just what it sounds like
from other countries. Yeah.
Sometimes people are expressive.
Yeah.
All right, Karen, are you ready?
I think I'll be okay. Let's do this.
Here we go.
This is exciting.
Right.
Bill Murray is back.
This is your Star Wars.
Right? Shut the front door.
It gets better.
Shuttle bus to the fair.
Funny Bill Murray is back.
Shun the firstborn.
It's Rock the Kasbah. Karen, here we go.
New Bill Murray movie. New Bill Murray movie. New Bill Murray movie.
The Sharif don't like it.
Actually, before you begin, Karen, I want to give a shout out to Mike McNutt of the Great Hater Nation podcast.
Yay, Mike McNutt!
Who sent us these Rock the Kasbah posters that we have adorning our
great poster,
Admirals Club this week.
It's a fantastic poster. Thank you, Mike.
So,
that's
Mike's
very
the man.
Cool.
TheHaterNationShow.com, or just go to iTunes and Podbean and look for The Hater Nation, their show where they go off on everything every week.
They do.
They're just
hysterical.
Crazy.
If you think we're a little reserved, that might be the way to go. Yeah.
We don't have a big porn section.
No, we should.
It's a movie, right? We should probably incorporate these. Well, so if we don't cover it, go there.
Go there, they'll cover it.
All right, Karen, take
it. All right, yes. After taking a decade off to knock it out of the park as a dry supporting character actor, making even the most unwatchable movies watchable. Isn't that right, Charlie's Angels? Bill Murray is back.
God damn it, Bill fucking Murray!
Sure, Bill Murray is always amazing.
Yes.
But it's tough to enjoy Broken Flowers, Bill Murray, right? But you remember this guy?
And as we wind on down the road, my shadow's calling and I'll
Again, goosebumps.
What a genius.
The last time Bill Murray was a lead in a comedy was The Man Who Knew Too Little. Which you should rewatch, but just watch him.
Yeah, seriously.
Yeah, don't watch other people.
Bill Murray. Bill Groundhog Day ghost busting ass Murray.
Bill Murray plays Billy Murray, playing Richie Lanz, a washed up music talent manager who takes his only remaining client and last hope at hitting it big on tour in Afghanistan. Mm-hmm. And you thought doing shows in the dirty South was a tough gig.
What kind of music do you usually have here?
Oh, we got both kinds. We got country and western.
In between dodging IEDs and scurvy, Richie discovers a young Afghan girl with a one-in-a-million voice and decides to sign her up to compete on a television show called Afghan Star. I think I speak for everyone when I say, I didn't know they had television out now in Afghanistan.
And the young starlet is well on her way to becoming an international sensation while risking a punishment of death because her religion doesn't allow women to sing. But then Simon Cowell shows up and calls her a talentless cunt and dashes her Hollywood dreams.
Richie is abandoned by his client.
That's what they say in England.
It's a different word for them. It's like fag and cigarette. It's a different word.
I don't think they talk. They just probably just shoot her in the head, right?
Yeah.
They just
over
go.
There, well,
not in England.
That becomes a very interesting show.
It's a different show. Richie is abandoned by his client, presumably when she comes to her senses and realizes that she's on tour in Afghanistan, leaving him stranded in Kabul, the city of brotherly love, of lights, the Big Apple. What is Kabul the city of?
Explosions. I'm pretty sure Kabul is a city of explosions.
Ah, great. The film's colorful poster will make audiences think this is going to be one funky-looking film. Or they'll just wonder how much Bill Murray brand weed is for sale.
Which genius on Rotten Tomatoes will be the first to label this film Kabul shit?
Fortunately, the film has been screened internationally, and already critics in Afghanistan have weighed in. The Daily Outlook says, we should be so lucky to wake up next to Bruce Willis in our bed.
Kabul Weekly, the Daily Outlook. Kabul Weekly says Bill Murray is a revelation. Does he live here now?
The Sharia Times writes, death to America.
Well, every review.
Sure. Rotten Tomatoes, that's ridiculous.
they're gonna just call them right in there. Right?
Yep,
you're going to see them right there next to the Barnsdale Press.
It's called aggregating.
And so, as so often happens with actors who are known for playing themselves more so than for playing any character, mm-hmm. they eventually become a full-on caricature of themselves to the point of absurdity. And in Bill Murray's case, this is indeed happening. Hmm. Much to everyone's delight. Bill Murray is more Bill Murray in this movie than we've seen him before, and we can't wait to see it.
To borrow from Bart's love of Tom Cruise.
Yes, please.
If you want Bill Murray in your movie, you can't do better than Bill Murray.
You can't do it.
Just get Bill Murray. He's available.
He's the Bill Murray.
He's hard to find, but if you can find him.
He's the Bill Murrayist.
And I want to paint it black.
Here's our problem is that
so
we have built a social calendar.
Yes.
In our lives, where we're having a Halloween party tomorrow.
I was just checking to see when that movie
and then we have
playing.
Work during the day, and then Friday night we have our Ghostbusters screening. Oh, I should announce it by the way. Speaking of
cool.
Bill Murray,
well, that's Friday also night, quite Karen, I would say.
Friday night at the Yumi Credit Union in Burbank, They've been turning their parking lot into a drive-in movie, except you don't drive in. You walk in, you sit down, and they project movies on the side of the building, and they're showing Ghostbusters. We'll be hosting.
Yep.
We've invited some of the folks from the Southland Ghostbusters to come join us in full costume for photo ops and walk around and stuff. Food trucks, local vendors. We're going to do trivia and give away prizes. It's going to be tons of fun. So that's Friday night. So when are we going to see this?
I'm looking right now on MoviePass, and they don't have the show times up yet. But I am not above checking tomorrow, and if there's like an 11:40 screening, I'm leaving the party.
Yeah, sorry, folks. You're kicking the people out of our house.
I have things to do.
Let me know.
Oh, all right.
I want to come see a Bill Murray movie with you.
Oh, yeah, there you go.
Yeah, it'd be so fun.
Gosh, I'm so excited. I'm just so excited. You guys are excited about Star Wars.
Yeah, yeah, it's the same thing. That's the thing. I'll go see a movie with anybody that's really excited about the movie. You know,
I think the last time I remember thinking Bill Murray was being the Bill Murray I absolutely adore, because I love this other stuff too, Broken Flowers. I rewatched that, and I just think it's adorable, him and his relationship with that neighbor.
I'm over that. But I mean, it's cool that he can do it.
But I remember What About Bob was the last time I felt like he was being Bill Murray.
Yeah,
such a solid Bill Murray situation right there.
St. Vincent, no?
Well, here's the thing about St. Vincent.
That was tricky.
I thought he was transitioning to old man roles, you know, because he was he had a stroke and everything,
funny.
And then it's like, oh, is he going to do the late Jack Lemmon switch into like older roles? But this is obviously proof that no, he still wants to headline and be the man in a comedy.
I mean,
so as much as I enjoyed St. Vincent, I did.
So two things: when in St. Vincent, when because now hopefully people have seen it by now. Have you seen it, Bart?
No, I just remembered he was in it.
Oh God! Anyway,
that's what I'm here for.
For those of you who have gone out of your home in the last year. I just love that in that movie, because I have a thing, like, don't kill a dog in a movie, or I'm already hating your movie.
Yeah,
they know not to kill Bill Murray in that movie, because he goes down, starts to black out, but they don't kill him.
Oh.
Because if they had killed Bill Murray,
it'd be Zombie Land.
Well, then that's okay, though, for some reason.
You can kill him in
Zombie
Land?
That's different. Yeah, because he was dressed like a zombie, so it was okay.
He had it coming.
So what is the song he sings at the campfire?
At the campfire? Smoke on the Water.
Smoke on the Water. Okay, it's pure... I'm such a nerd about this. Pure Bill Murray genius, because he goes, smoke... What's the part
where... Smoke on the water and fire in the night?
In the night. But he starts to say...
changes it. Fire in the night sky!
He starts wrong, and then just unabashedly just changes it into the right word, and it's
I think he may have missed his calling. He could have been a singer. Could have been a nice...
But this is, is epic. This is lounge singer Bill Murray. Yeah. This is the Bill Murray we really want to see. You can like... It's great the Broken Flowers, because Chevy Chase couldn't go do that. I mean, it's great that Bill Murray...
Dan Aykroyd couldn't do it.
Dan Aykroyd, yeah. But this Bill Murray, and one of the most foremost scholars on Bill Murray is Stephen Lewis.
Yep.
And, I mean, it's... The genius of him in, like, all these small roles. The season 3 of Saturday Night Live... was after Chevy had transitioned out, Bill came in, but he wasn't quite accepted. And they said the first time he did Nick the Lounge Singer, it was like he was taking over the show all of a sudden. And that season 3 of Saturday Night Live is like, it's impressive.
All right, let's get on to our final film, because then we got to get our guest in here. So
yeah,
Karen, there is one more.
I know.
But you just keep thinking of Bill Murray.
I will have to after this.
Our final film is Gem and the Holograms, about a band who makes music. But don't worry, to appeal to kids, the instrument playing is kept to a minimum in the trailer. Adam, let's go.
You know, it's a good thing they call this movie Gem and the Holograms, because that's the only way to know that this is based on the famed cartoon series that ran alongside Transformers and G.I. Joe in the 80s.
If you want to know what year Gem originally aired, I'll give you a hint. Holograms is in the title, the latest technology that 1985 had to offer your trapper keeper.
The cartoon was the story of a music manager whose computer would transform her into a female rock star, Gem, when she said...
Showtime, Synergy. Now, Synergy, showtime.
I think Denny is showtime. In pain watching this.
He's in the green room.
Oh, God.
Showtime, Synergy.
I swear to God, I know for a fact that Rock the Kasbah, Ricky Lance is not going to say showtime, Synergy, or whatever crap's showtime happening.
They may not say it in the movie Gem and the Holograms either.
They may not. They're actually doing the second trailer.
They're not horribly.
Very faithful in that line.
Oh, did they really?
Very faithful to the cartoon in that one line. Yes, yes.
All right, listen, we now take you to the meeting at Famous Hollywood Studios, where the 80s cartoon is now being adapted for 2015. The second voice you hear is overpaid. Action.
So, how do we make the kids like this movie about, you know, stuff and things?
The internet.
Here's your money for your expertise in updating old properties.
Thank you.
Well, there you go. Yes, in the Gem for a New Generation, she's an internet star, as the trailer will tell you a lot. In the cartoon, she was the leader of the band, the Holograms. You know, like in the title of the movie. But you can tell that didn't test well, because in this movie, she signs a contract to make her a solo star. Like on The Voice, like you kids like so much.
Also missing from the movie is the villains from the cartoon, the evil female band, the Misfits. Instead, the villain has changed to the amorphous price of fame on friendship.
Also, she has to get over the loss of her father who died and left her a robot like you kids liked in Big Hero 6 so much.
Aubrey Peoples plays Jerrica Benton, a small-town girl plucked from the internet and thrust into the fast-paced, high-stakes world of music. You know, the last time the music world plucked someone from the internet, Justin Bieber happened. So, you know, music world. Might want to stop with the plucking.
It's an inspirational story about chasing that impossible dream or remaining true to yourself and never letting go of your roots and never losing your sight of what makes you, you.
Hi, girls.
You are no longer Jerrica.
Jem.
That's what we call you now.
That means changing the way you act, sound, and look.
This is us? No, it's Photoshop.
Things are going great.
You highlighted
Things are going great for the group until one day Jem is approached by a record label to go solo. As you might suspect, this causes quite a bit of tension in the group as the rest of the Holograms start to feel abandoned by Jem.
Oh, and there's some stuff about a robot that Jerrica's dead father made, which comes to life and projects an Obi-Wan Kenobi-like message in the middle of all the turmoil. That's in this movie, too.
A hologram is a technology that gives the illusion of something being real, but is, in fact, little more than just flashes of light and sound. And this movie is an embodiment of that idea. It's kind of a movie about nothing, really. Don't believe me? Here, take a listen to the soundtrack.
She told me in the morning she don't feel the same about us in her bones.
See? Doesn't get any more nothing than that.
Weirdly, the trailer begins exactly like a Paranormal Activity trailer.
What are you working on?
Well, I'm working on my greatest creation. I promise you'll see it when you're a little older, okay?
Okay.
Yeah, it's VHS found footage. It's confusing, but not as confusing as when I saw the name of the producer of Paranormal Activity on the credits of Gem. It's true. I had no idea what the hell I was researching. So I have to either assume that there's a hidden quality to Gem that I'm not seeing in the trailer, or she's murdered by a possessed keytar.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You know, I'll take either outcome, really. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But there's only so disappointed you can be in the adaptation of a toy commercial from 1985. What would I really do with Stanley Kubrick's Rainbow Bright?
That I'd like to see.
So, Jim.
That's Jim.
This defines also coming out, because
There are two trailers for this movie.
That's
one,
true.
One where they don't mention the robot at all.
Uh-huh.
It's just a story about a girl who finds fame and fortune and has to decide whether she's going to have a solo career. And then there's another one that starts with a robot that has a bunch of stories to tell her.
Yeah, and another way of saying that is there's one that bears no resemblance to the cartoon at all.
All right.
And the second one that came out after everyone bitched about that.
All right, so here's the thing. I've never seen Jem the cartoon.
I love it.
Only saw one trailer. What? There's a robot?
So the story, from what I can piece together, is her father was an inventor who created this little robot that projected holographic
it's
messages.
It's Synergy. It's the Showtime Synergy.
Is that what it is?
Yeah, that's what it is.
And so when she's going through all this trouble, she like turns to the robot, and the robot dispenses all sorts of wisdom and sage advice.
But it's all pre-recorded wisdom, right?
I guess from her father,
from her dad.
Yeah.
You know, I saw a thing on Oprah one time where this woman who had like a 6-year-old knew that she was dying of cancer. So she went and she thought of all the different things she'd want to tell her daughter about on her wedding day and what and this and that. So she made all these little VHS tapes. This is kind of like that.
Yeah. This will not make you care more, but I do believe it's... I do believe he creates artificial intelligence in the robot.
Oh, okay. But it doesn't work right away. They like futz with it, and all of a sudden it comes to life.
Yeah, and it looks like Paranormal Activity at that point.
Yeah.
Well, after the first trailer, it looks so random that there's a robot.
Oh,
and the second one, I mean...
Well, when do robots have anything to do with YouTube?
In the international trailer, they get a song on the radio, and they all go, "We're on the radio!"
Yes.
In the one in American, they don't do that. Because, you know, you have...
Yeah, that was the difference. There's an international trailer that does not mention the robot. Yeah. And then the American one has the robot.
You know what's really kind of cool? There's a guy coming up who actually knew musicians. Let's just go talk to him.
Oh, yeah. Let's take a break then. And for a 10-second break, we'll be back with our guest, Denny Tedesco of The Wrecking Crew. Stay tuned. With our guest segment, joining us is the director of The Wrecking Crew, which chronicles the people who make up the unsung heroes of the studio musician world in the 60s and 70s. It's available now on demand and in select theaters. Again, go to wreckingcrew.tv to find that out. And our guest's father, Tommy Tedesco, was one of these legendary guitarists. So we're happy to have the filmmaker who's telling his story with us here, Denny Tedesco, everybody.
Yay! Please sit down, yay, all those people.
There you go.
More applause.
Love your green room, by the way. Your green room's awesome.
Thank you very much.
You should, you should really share it with the folks out there one day.
It's it's so back there. Sometimes they don't the guests don't even get
The video
the shrimp
feed.
Plate we send you. Did you get the shrimp that you didn't have to go somewhere else?
Is there gum? We usually have gum.
Only under the table.
We had red vines. Exactly. I think the red vines have hardened though there somewhere.
You could take out a filling with those now.
Red sticks is what we've got now.
So we'll talk about The Wrecking Crew in a second, because it's we saw it and it's fantastic. But
we're just talking Gem.
We're talking it's a musical month, especially this week with Gem and the Holograms, and Rock the Kasbah. Bill Murray is a music manager. Any thoughts on the new releases coming out?
What's going on with Gem?
I have no idea what the hell you guys are talking about, Gem. I felt like I was in France listening to you guys. Or I'm American listening to French talk. I have no idea what the hell Gem is.
I know.
And I feel really out of place. I felt like either I smoked a lot of pot in the 80s, which I did.
I didn't see it in the 80s either. Yeah.
Not to feel bad about not knowing what Gem is. I am a fan of toy commercial cartoons, like cartoons that were built to sell toys.
Right.
So it was that your G.I. Joe and Transformers are making hand over fist money in the 80s, and so they rushed out some other ones for girls like Gem and the Holograms.
Wow.
But it is only known to some people who were right age to watch every cartoon that existed.
So it was only a cartoon?
Yeah.
Oh.
No, I mean, it's a toy line, too.
It was an action figure.
Yeah,
but it wasn't a live-action TV show?
So it's going
show,
for preteens, right? They were going for the young.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, like 10-year-old girl.
Does she really wear red on her face?
Yeah. She does. That is accurate. She looks like kind of like David Bowie.
And it was kind of otherworldly, right? We knew it was all ingrained that there was this robot and these powers
and
stuff.
That was a given. There was all kinds of sci-fi givens in this commercial.
Right. So when I saw this American Idol-centric ad for this movie, it is confusing.
Oh, it might as well take Blue Valentine and call it G.I. Joe or something. It's like some weird teen love story, this movie. I don't know what the hell this movie is, but there are references to a cartoon called Gem in it. The title being one of those things.
I just think it's so fascinating because the idea behind the one trailer I saw, the one without the computer.
With the robot?
Without the robot. It's just this girl who records a song on her iPhone or whatever and her sister puts it up online and she's a huge star. Which is so kills me when I know about people now like Denny's dad who could have played all these people under the friggin' table because she... It just kills me.
It was a girl band made of cartoons.
Cartoons.
Much like the Backstreet Boys.
But then there's people who have actual talent and can play an actual instrument.
So speaking
of which. But they end up doing it anyways.
That's true. They do it anyways.
They do the soundtrack of those people. So what's the difference?
You just don't know.
That's true.
Yeah, you just have no idea that's who's playing the keytar for her.
Well, that's an interesting thing because there was a song every week on Gem. Either Gem or the Misfits would play a whole song. So they had to write 52 songs a year for that type of syndication.
And there's some singers out there getting
to
do that studio work. That's amazing.
Oh, Robbie Neville. Do you remember Robbie Neville?
Oh, yeah.
C'est la vie, which I actually worked on. That was at my loft, and we did that video at my place.
Oh, wow.
Cool. Oh,
wow.
But he was the writer on Hollywood, what was the kid's musical on Disney? Hollywood High School. What was it? The one.
Oh, I do know.
Oh God, it was
about
a huge thing for for a few years.
Yeah,
he did.
And they did songs on that all the time.
Yeah,
too.
Absolutely.
That's cool.
He made.
You're talking about High School Musical.
Yeah,
like Zac Efron.
High School.
Good for him.
So he was I think one of the head writers, if not.
Wow.
So he made a fortune off that thing.
Yeah,
it's great. Empire has songs every week. Some don't they? Isn't there songs in Empire?
Do you know anybody that worked on Cop Rock?
Actually, do.
I like Cop Rock.
All right, so go. All right, so this is the conversation that we had earlier.
See, I'll ask the good questions. I'll ask the good questions.
Look, ooh, you remember? Look, goosebumps, goosebumps, goosebumps. So we walk into your living room, right? And I see what's the poster? Little Shop of Horrors.
Little Shop, yeah.
Little Shop of Horrors, which is Lee Wilcoff was the original Seymour. Which worked on Cop Rock.
Oh my God.
The original Seymour from Roger Corman's movie?
No, from Broadway.
From Broadway. Off Broadway.
Yeah. Which is very weird. The fact that you bring up Cop Rock, and that was what? Six
and you
shows?
Just, did you yeah, just maybe. Talk to him? It's kind of
literally
crazy.
Just talked to him like yeah.
that. Cop Rock is the TV show so version cool. of Jim and the Holograms.
Now
like,
that should come back.
It should come back. I want to be on Cop Rock.
Cop Rock, where is. We
gotta get that back.
Ahead of its time, though. You know, now musicals are back in a big way. You know,
totally.
Post, Chicago.
Well, I have a feeling we could name any artist and some find out the 6 degrees of separation which you're related to. But before we do that, let's lay the groundwork.
Tell the audience what's going on
for the listeners of who you are and what the film is all about.
Right.
So tell us about this Wrecking Crew.
The Wrecking Crew. It's the story of the session musicians, the ones that did all the recordings in the early 60s and 70s in Los Angeles. And they were doing the recordings for Elvis, the Beach Boys, like Pet Sounds, Sinatra, Jan and Dean, Mamas and Papas, Fifth Dimension, Johnny Rivers, Birds. Anything that was being done in L.A. most likely had a group of session musicians on it. And the reason was in the early 60s, you only had one track, and it was mono. So record labels who weren't sure if rock and roll was really going to be a sellable
item. Right, who knew, right?
Yeah. It's a fad.
Yeah, it might not be here next year.
That and rap.
So they made sure they cover their asses by basically putting session players in there. Because a lot of these bands could not play that well. Mm-hmm. And you had studios, you know, that's expensive, you know, time. So these guys come in, knock it out 3 hours, boom, 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 knock out three or four songs.
So that's my question. Did they play with the band or instead of the band?
Sometimes both.
Okay.
I mean, usually at the beginning, like it was like the Birds is a great example.
Yeah.
Mr. Tambourine Man. It's the only one they recorded. But Terry Melcher was the producer. And Terry said, well, if I'm going to do this, guys, I need to have my guys. I'll put Roger McGuinn in. He can sing lead and he can play the 12 string. But I'll have Hal Blaine on drums, Leon Russell on piano, Larry Nechtel on bass. And Bill Pittman and Jerry Colon.
So you're not listening to these guys when you're listening to the
albums.
Not
that one.
Not that one.
But here's what Roger McGuinn said in my interview with him. He said, listen, we did that song and the B-side in 3 hours. That's a three-hour session. When we did the group, turn, 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 it took 77 takes.
It's a totally different animal when you're in the studio. There's so many things you have to get right. You can't be worrying about if you're a good player or not.
No.
You can't.
I mean, the red light goes on. It's like, that's it. You better boom, 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 boom.
Yeah, there's no time.
And they had, you know, they could be in three or four sessions a day. They could go with the Beach Boys in the morning or later at night. They could be doing a movie or commercial. And that's how, you could look at my dad's workbook and it's like, okay, he's doing Green Acres on Monday.
Oh my God.
And then he's at Capitol later for something. That's him.
Yeah, that's him.
Okay, so and I did not get to see this, so I'm going to ask you questions like, who are you?
Now
tell me about your dad. Tell me about your dad.
Dad, Tommy Tedesco, came out of Niagara Falls, New York. He came, lovely Karen, she knows. She knows.
That is a very brave man to get out of there.
Not really. I don't think it's that brave to get
out. No, you want to get out. That's There's a great little story in the movie where the wife says that they
can't
go
back. That's
my
mother, by the way.
His mom says, we can't go back because there's two guys that said he would never make it. And that's all you need when you're from Western New York not to go back.
Yeah. No, they came out. They were dad was 23. Mm-hmm. In 1953, he actually went to a dance at Niagara University and the big band there was losing a guitar player. So they said, hey, my friend plays guitar. So all of a sudden my father's auditioning that night.
Okay.
And also he goes on the road, goes around the country, comes out here, does the Hoagy Carmichael show with his big band, sees all of Hollywood, sees studio musicians, gets to Dallas, gets fired. He gets fired.
Back to Hollywood?
He gets fired because he fired him and the singer so they could do some of the sing and play guitar.
That happens because you're able to downsize. That happened to when we were working for Disney. They had five of us.
Oh, Disney's perfect for that.
They were able to use two piano players and get rid of all of us.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Get rid of a six-person improv.
Yeah. Cheaper.
Exactly.
Yeah. It's easier to have a guy who can sing and play
instrument. They were ahead of their time in 1953, downsizing.
Yeah.
So basically, basically, so Dad was so ashamed by going back to Niagara Falls, New York. You know, don't forget, he wasn't... So basically, I said to my mom, I said, how long before you guys moved? A year, year and a half? She goes, no, 3 weeks.
That's all you can take. Wow. Once you've had a taste of freedom, yeah, you can't go back.
One of their first house was a few blocks from here in Burbank.
Really?
Yeah.
That's so cool.
Let's go take a tour.
Yeah, right? That is really cool.
But here's the kicker was when I asked my mom, I said, was Dad gigging a lot? You know, was he, you know, doing a lot of gigs? You know, 1953? She goes, no. She goes, he was working in a chemical factory. And once in a while, he'd get a casual, meaning like a wedding or something like that, but he wasn't working. She goes, he didn't want to go to that dance. He got a gig that night in Pennsylvania, and he was going to do that. She says, you can't go there because I spent $35 on this dress. So
if he hadn't gone to that gig, if it wasn't for my mother,
we would never be here today.
I did like the fact that you told a story about your mom said, put that guitar down and pay attention to me. And your dad said, well, look, it's between you and the guitar and you have legs.
Yeah, yeah. Basically, it's like...
You mean, and take a hike?
Yeah, yeah, it's like, honey, the guitar doesn't have legs. You do.
Mm-hmm. So. My mom and dad have had that conversation. Yeah. So, yeah.
But, you know, my dad's success, I can only say... is obviously it was a talent, but my mother, God bless her, she's still with us, but she was so strong, and they did it as a unit.
Yeah.
You know, they came here, mom was taking the calls, you know, she would deal with us, you know, it was a, you know, combined effort. They did
so how did
well.
He get into the music
basically,
industry?
Basically, you kind of start hanging out, you start jamming at jam sessions, you know, say, hey, can you cover me? Because I got this other job someone would do. So you start covering for that guy.
Like covering doing what?
Like, it could be dad would cover for, let's say, Howard Roberts, who was a great jazz guy at the time. Mm-hmm. He was playing for Peggy Lee. So dad plays for Peggy Lee.
Okay.
And then all of a sudden, this other guy, he got a shot with Bob Main. It was another guitar player. So we're doing a commercial, and it's a, you know, car commercial, whatever.
Yeah.
And that's how he just starts breaking in. And once... The thing what he was different was he could read fly shit, as they called it. Can we say fly shit on this?
Absolutely. Sure. Fly shit.
You could believe, yeah, go ahead.
Which is basically, you know, a lot of notes on paper.
Yeah.
And he was really good at it. And he really got good at it to where the point was that's where his career went later in the 80s and, you know, doing film and stuff.
Oh.
He could read it upside down. And the reason he could read it upside down was that's how he would practice. If he's reading a paper like this, okay, I read it that way, and let's do it this way. So he wouldn't memorize it.
Oh,
it's just basically a challenge.
So it forced him to always be reading?
Always.
God, that's cool.
I mean, can you imagine if you're going to work four times a day, different studios, different groups, different situations, and you're being thrown music all day long? Mm-hmm. It's not like a band where they're given the same music, you're practicing the same 12 songs. Yeah. You know, so he was giving
out. They'd said they record like an album a day.
They could do an album
like
a day,
that's
Liberty Records.
Crazy. I love that output.
Yeah, album,
it's
I mean. And that's mixing sometimes. Some of the stuff was mixed.
And that's stylistically different. Like, he could go in and be doing some Spanish guitar work in the morning and then later be doing...
Banjo.
Banjo. Oh, my God.
Or electric jazz or whatever it was.
Yeah.
I've only heard a couple things that your father worked on. Each time I went, wow!
Yeah.
Green Acres. You said Temple of Doom?
No, Temple of Doom was, with John Williams.
That's great.
He was doing a lot of stuff with John Williams. See, it's funny because later in life, they did all the Beach Boys and all this other stuff. And Pet Sounds. And then Dad did, like, Batman theme. So that's him on the Batman theme.
He's touched a superhero nerve.
So it got superhero next to me, huh?
Uh-huh, absolutely.
I thought you were superhero. But you don't have your hair on.
That's right, yes. He had a superhero hair.
Sorry.
He's the Tom Cruise guy.
I'm going to repeat the lyrics just to make sure I know the song you're talking about.
It's
na 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 na.
No, you're wrong. It's lyric.
Oh, it's just lyric.
Oh, yeah, it's lyric.
That was the running joke. Because the guy that actually did this, one of my interviews was with Ron Hicklin, the singer.
Yeah.
It was Ron Hicklin's singers that did Batman.
Oh, yeah.
And the joke was lyrics.
You get one sheet of paper.
Cool.
Yeah.
So the film eventually shows what happens to one of the I forget who was it that didn't have such a great end up a security guard after the
Hal Blaine
crew.
And probably he's one of the most, I mean, you hear his resume, you just freak.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, Charlie Watts said I was so disappointed when I heard, you know, 10 of my favorite drummers was Hal Blaine. Yeah, because it was like everything was Hal Blaine at the time. You know, he was doing the Beach Boys, he was doing Simon Garfunkel, he was doing Elvis, he was doing everything going on. And then Earl Palmer was another drummer. So what happened was these guys were so busy, and they get, you know, go through the 60s, and then all of a sudden there's more tracks. groups are getting better. Mm-hmm. Styles change. Carol King, you know, brings in, you know, her band. They're doing, you know, doing James Taylor, and they're doing their stuff. Mm-hmm. And the bands are self-sufficient at this point. So these guys, now there's another session, there's another group of session players that come in the 70s. You got like the Larry Carltons, the Dean Parks, right, and the Lee Rittenhouse and all these guys.
Russ Kunkel, do you ever work with him?
Yeah, Russ. And then you got Steve Gadd and Jeff Picarl. That was a whole nother, the next generation of right. guys. And they, you know, then they went on, but at that point, luckily for my dad, he went into TV and film.
I was just going
to
ask,
he could read, so he could go on to do the film scores and stuff.
Yeah,
yeah, there are clips of him lecturing and things like that. But he had a pretty sustainable career after the sort of Wrecking Crew days were over.
Yeah,
where he didn't lapse into
Too bad. And like the only sad story. Well, that's the only sad story. But I mean, Hal Blaine's sad story is he said my only regrets are my personal life, right, nothing to do with my when he had six wives.
That would cost you some cash. Yeah.
But as my father says, one of my favorite lines when he says, you know, I asked the question, how did it affect your personal lives going to the studio all the time? And Hal says, well, affected mine tremendously. I had six wives. And my father goes, yeah, but that was because your personality, not because you're a drummer.
It takes a certain kind of wife to be able to understand that it's a business, because it sounds like your mom was helping to facilitate the business.
She was. And
so she was involved.
Very much so. And, you know, in a lot of ways, exactly.
There was one very... My friend was watching it with me, and this kind of perked up her ears. It was when Carol Kay talked about, I think my daughter's okay. I think they're okay.
Yeah.
I think they're all right.
Yeah. That's
and it was a little question whether or not her family was okay with what happened.
Yeah, unfortunately, Carol's daughter did end up passing.
She
passed a few years ago, but that was cancer and stuff.
Oh, okay.
But
that made me sad, because she couldn't say, my kids were great.
Well,
she was
That's interesting, because she was a single woman most of the time, you know, raising, I don't know how she
did it. Oh, was she a single mom?
I think so.
Okay.
I mean, I don't think she didn't have a good marriage.
Okay.
A couple marriages. And you know, one of the greatest lines in the movie for me, and this is how it affects me, is I asked Plas Johnson, the great sax man who did the Pink Panther thing.
Oh, my God.
You know.
Yeah, it's amazing.
Can you imagine? Yeah. The guy that played saxophone. Yeah.
On so I'm blowing it.
Adam,
for this
it's just
guy.
One guy. No, but Adam, it's just one guy after another.
Like,
he did that, and he did this, and he did that.
I remember your story, because I just want to interject real quick, because I love this about your movie. Adam, so he does this really great technique where he'll have that gentleman playing sax, and he'll be playing the sax, and then he lays in what you used to hearing,
sure,
and you just want to go, are you kidding me?
And sometimes he'll fade back out.
And they'll fade back out to the guy just playing it, and you're like, what is happening?
And he's like, he's
and
it.
It's funny because that's the only song, though, where you know right off the bat.
You totally do. It's a reveal.
That's a solo, right?
It's totally a reveal. Yeah. He's right, because some other ones will start playing
I try to hide it. That was the thing. It started because Carol would always play with her bass, and someone said when we were starting to edit, so you got to get more of those guys playing. It's like, where am I going to get these guys playing? They don't even, you know, barely get together. So I thought, I put them in the studio, and put Hal in the studio, put headphones on them, and I said, here's Hal, here's a dozen songs, you know, Beach Boys, Ronettes.
Yeah.
Bum, bum, bum. You know, that's it. You know, then we're off and flying.
How cool was that?
Oh, he's great. He's amazing. So that's how I kind of did it. And then I started doing, it's like, okay, let's start with that and fade it in. Same thing
with
Joe Osborne. And
it's a really great technique, because it's like a game. You go, what is that? And then when you realize it, you're like, shut up.
It's interesting. You know, the other one I couldn't start at the beginning, the top of the head, or the head, whatever you call it, is Boots Were Made for Walking.
Oh,
that was fascinating.
So I had to start that in the middle, because it's like, all right, I can't give it away now.
She's right, though, when she said that it's that dumb, dumb, dumb kind of bass sound.
Nancy Sinatra.
But this
Nancy
is a testament Sinatra. To the awesome. To the best enjoyment of the movie, is that you know that bass line. You have no idea who plays it.
And when you see
and
it,
that's a famous bass line.
And that's Chuck Berghoff.
So now you'll find out when you watch.
So exciting. And also, for guys out there who want to get laid, become a musician, because there's this guy.
That's why my dad did it.
Who's so.
But a session musician, can you get just as laid from being a session musician?
Nancy,
that's my question.
You can get Nancy Sinatra.
What?
Because I don't know who this guy was that married her,
but he
was a normal looking dude, and there's a cute little picture of this, like, normal guy next to the hottest Nancy Sinatra.
And Randy something,
he's
right?
Down Randy.
Don Randy, yeah.
Adorable, but I love the fact that he got Nancy Sinatra.
No, all right, let's clear this up right to camera.
Oh, no.
Okay.
Don is not married to Nancy.
Oh.
They just sit next to each other on a couch.
I thought he got it.
But this is good. This is how rumors start. And Don's going to hear
Tell Don that I think they look great together.
No, Don was, he's been, her
is
musical
Nancy,
director.
Is Nancy married?
Not right now, no.
Don. Oh, Don.
Don is.
Oh,
I got on a
never
huge
mind.
Nancy's
actually, Don's
married.
Not married now either.
Nancy.
Things just changed.
How by the things way,
Nancy Sinatra's really,
well,
really good in this.
Apple
cool.
Music just has the three months for free, right? And you can listen to anything like Spotify. I got on this Nancy Sinatra kick this week.
I'm telling you.
You can listen to everything. It's all good. It's really enjoyable. It's great, like, ambling about music.
You
like,
got,
I listen to, like, whole Nancy Sinatra.
I know you like looking at the ladies. Go watch the video for that because he shows a clip of it.
Oh, but those
so
dancers,
hot.
It's like the video or the
those
video of the
dancers
day.
Dancers are so
the
hot.
Boots were made for walking.
Oh, my God.
Now, think about where those ladies are today. They're probably in their 80s.
God!
I hate to burst your bubble, but I mean, imagine.
So what you're saying is I got a shot?
Yeah.
I,
got
that, I like it.
Especially
like
in
it.
Radio.
Bring in Burt Reynolds' wig.
I have a question about the session because I heard you interviewed on KPCC with Larry Mantle, and it's got me thinking about the whole idea of having somebody who's not the band play the music on the album that you buy. That's happening, right? That's what's happening.
It's always happened.
So my question is, because you're familiar with AFFM, we're all union people.
Yeah.
Does session guitarists also mean you get paid for that session and that's it?
Oh, that's it.
That's
no,
it.
No. Yes and no.
So there's no back end. So somebody else plays your song, and then you collect all the residuals on that.
Yes and no. Here's
well, this is why you're here.
Yeah. All right. There's the guys do get they get their
answer
session
is residual
fee.
Question.
They get their session fee, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, but they also get another fee if that song goes into a movie or it goes into a commercial or goes.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Or,
yeah.
Like
through
if
the
you
AFFM,
guys
but on the album, they don't get any of the album money.
No.
They don't get any of the publishing money. They don't get the master money.
No, but here's what my father says. Even in the movie, he says it. Mm-hmm. He says, "Listen, we made hundreds of hits, but we made thousands of bombs."
Yeah.
He says, "I never gave anybody their $25 back."
I loved when he said that because he said if they paid him their $25 and he knew it wasn't any good, he kept that money.
Yeah.
I loved when
he said that. That's how we all work.
Yeah.
You know, it's kind of like should you get? That's your job. Is once you're there, you're there to get the next job. We're all there.
Yeah. So was the Wrecking Crew?
They weren't a set band. They weren't by the.
They weren't a nomenclature that they used amongst themselves.
They what? What's that?
That wasn't a nomenclature they used amongst themselves.
No.
A name. Okay.
No.
They didn't put
no
it in
actually,
the
Wrecking Crew. The Wrecking Crew never really came out until the '90s. That's
gotcha.
A made up name later.
Oh, it was made up after
the
fact.
It was because the older guys, used to say these guys are going to wreck the business playing this rock and roll because rock and roll was a dirty, dirty word in 1960. And in the studio,
really?
Yeah,
it wasn't embraced as the new thing, as the
no, really, because the older guys, the other studio musicians, they're looking at like these three chords, and it's like what a bunch of stupid crap.
Yeah,
you know,
that's true.
And they didn't. And a lot of these jobs at the beginning were not demos. Demos were illegal in the union, so the older guys didn't want to take a chance because they would get them busted, or they were cash dates. So these younger guys, who were my dad, Hal Blaine, Carol,
and who had nothing to lose,
Glenn Campbell. Was
Glenn
great,
Campbell
was
is
one
amazing.
Of the great session players.
Yeah.
Leon Russell, another great session player. They would all do these things, and then all of a sudden they became the ones in demand. Now they're getting double scale. At mid-60s, they're all getting double scale. Their union, everything's going, you know, no one's messing with them.
So Leon Russell started as a session musician?
Yeah.
Yeah, I wanted to say, I'm
so did Glenn
Campbell. Glad as we went along, we got to the film chronicled Glenn's transition
Me
into
too.
Headlining and all that. How did it happen for Leon?
Leon, I think, was just sick of it. You know, it's funny because I just did an outtake. I cut another outtake the other day and looking at the transcripts. And he said, you know, I asked him one of the questions I asked, which was great. I said, "Leon, were you," I said, "how did you deal with the music sometimes? You know, because it gets monotonous." He says, "I was bored as shit." You know, he says, "after 10 times you do the same track, you know, you don't even read the music anymore." He "start making up my own lyrics to the song." Mm-hmm. Can you imagine the lyrics he might have done for Gary Lewis and the Playboys or maybe a Sonny and Cher song?
Oh, yeah. My God.
You know.
Do you guys know that Cher was a backup singer?
She started as a backup singer.
Yeah.
But it was because Sonny took her, who was, I think, 19, and she was, what, 16, took her to the sessions with Spector. And Spector would always throw, Phil would always throw the guys, everybody, you go back there, you sing with the girls, Sonny, take a tambourine.
It was the Ronettes she sang with, right?
Was Be My Baby, I think, was her first gig. But it was like literally Larry Levine said, you know, push Cher back, further back, further back, you know, away from the mic. You know, because she, cause her voice was just going right through.
Yeah, because she had a very specific quality.
Yeah. Wow. You know, so she learned. She learned a lot, you know, at the beginning.
And she's charming in the interview you had
with her.
She's
great.
Yeah. She's really lovely.
You know,
in
and,
it.
And everybody thought, how the hell did you get Cher?
I was thinking that.
And, and it was one of those things where.
Do you know Kathy Griffith? Is that how you got her?
No, but I do. I mean, I've worked with her.
Oh, okay. I love Kathy.
Because that's how I would try to get to Cher. I'd go to Kathy first.
I never thought about that.
Yeah. Then you go hang out in her bathroom.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
No, I was. I worked with her many, many years ago on a rock video in the 80s. And I remember standing next to her. I was a grip at the time. And I said, you know, shyly, I said, Cher, my dad worked with you in the 60s. Who's your dad? You know, like,
yeah.
And I said, Tommy Tedesco. And went, and she melted.
Aww.
You know, and it was like, oh my God, Tommy and Billy and Hal. And, you know, that's how she went. And I thought, okay, I got it.
That's that same thing that she brought to this.
Yes. So I knew. Yeah. And the reason was she was 16. Those were good years.
Yeah.
She didn't have to deal with these, you know, being the star. And that same thing with with Glenn. Glenn Campbell said that he says the session years were my best.
Wow.
He didn't have the pressure of being, you know, I wasn't bored when I was on my show. I was bored. It was all these rehearsals. We're in sessions. He was going boom, boom, boom. He's, you know, doing Sinatra, and then he's doing the Beach Boys, and he's doing, you know, all this stuff. You never get bored.
And you talk about, you know, her being 16. I mean, also, she could have come across any sort of nefarious person in the industry.
Oh, yeah.
You know, but obviously these guys.
But so she came across Phil Spector.
Right.
Yeah, exactly.
Good point.
He said any.
But the Wrecking Crew guys, again, just the studio guys who come in and out of her life.
Well, she didn't smack you when you mentioned your father's name.
No, yeah. That's a good point. Time.
All seem very cool. Now, but so this brought up a question Karen and I had when we were done. There's relatively little mention of. Like, I watch so many music biopics now, and it's all biopics. When did they start taking drugs, and when did everything go horrible?
Yeah.
Was that a big factor back then?
No, that wasn't. The reason is, and I asked this question, I knew there wasn't at my house because Dad hated drugs. Because Dad, I told you earlier off camera or off mic, I said, you know, Dad was like freaky about, like, he had to have control. Forget about Novocaine at the dentist. It was like he did not. He was. Freaked out about it, so he never did any drugs. And also, they're going to a session; they got to be on time. Mm-hmm. They got to be in and out in 3 hours. Now, maybe the percussionist, not Hal, didn't do it either, but maybe some of the percussionists, like Gary Coleman, was doing some stuff, and Amel was doing some stuff. These guys, they were dabbling in pot and stuff, but you had to be really professional, and you really had to get in and get out.
Jazz cigarettes.
Yeah. and usually it was like, if that was it, don't forget there's a lot of reading involved. So
yeah, you have to be sober enough to be able to keep
but,
your
you know,
job.
But maybe one of them got addicted and was unable to do all that. But that's not chronicled in the film, so I just assume it didn't happen.
Get out of here, dude. Doing weed.
Yeah, I think it came. Like, yeah, I think it later came more. It seemed like it was more behind the in the booth more with the and it came later in
maybe
the 60s.
Maybe the producers and stuff.
Don't forget that we're talking about early 60s. You know.
Right.
And I think later 60s is starting to come in, and late, you know, 70s. Now they're long, you know, one of the guys, Al Schmidt, said, who's the great engineer, producer, and what was he doing? Jefferson Airplane, I think it was. And he said, there was a bowl of Coke. And they just kept going at it. It just got getting worse and worse and worse.
See, that's going to waste money and time.
It did, you know? Always. That's how all the rock videos in the 80s, there was wasted time.
It makes you really efficient for a half hour.
Yeah. and it's the best half hour.
Great half hour.
So whenever we were watching the end of the movie, I know a little tiny bit about session musicians just because I love Lyle Lovett. And in my stalking of Lyle Lovett, I got to know his band. And his band is made up of some of the best musicians and studio musicians, like Russ Kunkel.
Right.
He goes on tour with them. We got to meet him a couple of times. And one time, I there's a place called the Cowboy Palace up in Chatsworth. I don't know if you know it, but it's this old.
I live there.
You would love it.
I live near there, but I
don't. Oh my gosh, it's this crazy Cowboy Palace. It's an old honky tonk, the first honky tonk, and they have a talent contest. And so what I would do is I would play some songs that my dad and I used to play, these old country songs, and I'd go up there and make some money because you win like $50. So I'd take my guitar up there and I'd go and you just. Plug in and you play your guitar and you tell the band what key it is and they play. And there's a couple of different guys and this and that. But on my right was always a steel guitarist. And he was super cool and I didn't know who he was. And I was like, hey. So he would play this like Mama Tried. He would take that whole thing and be kick ass. I'm like, yeah. So that happened for a while, and then my friend got me backstage to see Lyle after his performance downtown. And so I'm talking to Lyle, and that was cool. And then I saw Mitch, who is Mitch Watkins, who he tours with. That's his guitarist. And Mitch was talking to this guy, and the guy looked familiar, but I didn't know who it was. So I went over to Mitch, and Mitch introduced me to Dean Parks, who was the guy who originates all of the guitar tracks on Lyle's albums, because that's who records in the studio. Yeah. This is the first I'd ever heard of this. Like, I didn't know that the band I saw with Lyle was not who was always on this CD and stuff. So I thought, well, that's kind of interesting. Cut to the next week. I go to that damn Cowboy Palace. I'm getting out my guitar. I look on stage and I'm like, holy shitballs. I've been playing with Dean Parks for months.
Dean Parks was playing steel?
That's why he was doing it, because he's an amazing guitarist, but he wanted to get his chops up on steel.
That's a trip.
So he would go and sit in.
Where he didn't give a shit.
With whoever the hell.
He didn't give a shit. Yeah.
It was amazing.
Like Karen. He doesn't give a shit about Karen.
So Dean would play steel, which is incredibly hard. And he would play for doofuses like me, and he'd practice on me.
Doofy. Yeah.
And people don't know who they're playing with.
I had no idea.
I'm just singing my song, and right there, bitch, you don't know, right next to Dean Parks has played with everybody.
Wow,
who plays
great.
With Lyle Lovett, who I can't even deal with.
Can I ask a question for our audience? What is the difference between steel guitar and regular guitar?
On your lap.
Oh, it's the one that lays flat.
On your lap,
like,
and then
that.
You use a bar, and then you kind of slide the bar.
And it kind of has it.
And what you don't even think about is there's all these pedals. So not only are you sliding the guitar and you're picking with all these picks, but then you're changing the chords and stuff with your feet. And so it's really like a circus act.
Yeah. It's funny. It's the only guitar my dad actually didn't have in his arsenal.
I believe
because in his arsenal, he had in his cases, he had bazookies and mandolins and tipples. And
he could do banjo.
And banjos and everything. And he would do
Yeah.
But he would have it. It didn't mean he had to play it the great. Because don't forget, he's in the studio. If he's doing a movie like we were talking about Temple of Doom, he's being called for electric sitar.
Right.
Now, instead of sitar.
Instead of getting Ravi Shankar, who might not be able to read John Williams' music, you need you got to read something. So it's going to be electric sitar, because he can play electric sitar, and he's just next time you watch it, just watch that scene with the monkey eating out of the head.
Oh, the monkey brains.
Yeah,
that whole dinner scene.
And you just hear the sitar going all over. But the thing is, he only needs to know so much to get across that that's what it is. Mm-hmm. So if he's doing like banjo, like southern banjo, he just, he hated the banjo. But you know what? He played it and pretended like he loved it.
Does it play similar to the sitar, the banjo?
No, I mean, different scenes. Different scenes.
Yeah, and also the banjo, it's going to have a different number of strings.
Yeah.
And then there's picks that you put on your fingers.
He had to learn a whole different skill.
But he would always tune every instrument was tuned like a guitar.
Oh, so he knew where the chord formations were.
Because then he
didn't. Smart.
Because then he knows exactly. He had a $5,000 Ramirez guitar, doesn't have any of those dots.
Uh-huh.
Oh, he put dots on. Because he needs to know. He says, I can't tell John Williams, it's the right tuning, even though I can't play it.
Right.
It's not going
to
blend.
So he's able to put it into a tuning that's universal for him.
Absolutely.
And that way, no matter what, because it's just about shapes on your left hand.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Maybe you could give me a lesson, because I don't know.
For anybody not watching the YouTube video, what Karen is doing is called geeking out. It's what I did at the beginning when they Star Wars.
Yes, exactly.
Paul, now there's some stuff here we need to
back to drugs, though. There's a great outtake.
Please go back to drugs.
Yes.
It's a great outtake. Carol Kay's talking to my father. It's the first time they've been together in years, and they're backstage, whatever, getting ready. And she goes, I'm so glad my kids didn't get into the business, and it's really tough, and da da da. And she says to my father, they're talking and commiserating about the kids not doing music, and my father says, it's a tough business, and they're just off camera, or they don't know they're on camera. And she goes, yeah, because I don't want him to get into drugs. He goes, no, I got him into drugs. No. Which is not true.
No, I made sure they did drugs.
Yeah.
A couple more quick things.
Yeah.
What is the favorite song your father ever played on?
I think it was always going to be with a Spanish guitar. Mm-hmm. Probably for rock and roll, probably would have been, rock and roll, Memories with Elvis, the comeback special.
Really? Oh, wow.
Oh, did he play in the comeback special? On stage?
Like, on stage? Yeah. Like, he's in the comeback
special? Oh, he's in the audience.
Shut the front
door. No, not in the audience. He's in the band. So that
Yeah.
That's Paul's favorite.
Well, as far, I'm a in the Beatles, Stones, Elvis argument, I'm a Beatles guy.
Right.
But that comeback special is the high point of Elvis's career.
It's great.
It's when he had the most charm. It's when he had the best look. It's when he had the best players around him. I mean, those Vegas bands were amazing, too, the ones in Hawaii.
And that was
man, I love that pared down. And your dad was in that. That's just crazy.
That's cool.
He had the orchestra, and he had his band, and that stuff that, like the Spanish guitar, you know, memories at the beginning. So anytime he got to play that and have real feeling towards his playing, he said, you know, and then later, like we were going back to Horner, James Horner, or Goldsmith, or...
Whoa. Did your father play on one of James Horner's
scores? Yeah, a lot of them, because he was always the Spanish reading. See, Dad had such respect from these guys because he could read fly shit, and he had such feeling about that the Latin guitar. So, like Cocoon, you know, and... Feel the Dreams.
Ugh.
Now the Feel the Dreams is a drag because they didn't use that theme. It's on the CD.
Okay.
But if you ever pick up the CD, it's beautiful.
Yeah.
But he said that's what I want to be known for.
Yeah.
He said anybody could pick up the Telecaster, and any one of the guys could have done. You know, there's 12 guitar players.
Yeah.
But when Horner or those guys are saying, "Can you keep the first 2 weeks in March open, and you're still a couple months away because we got a movie coming up?" That means they're asking for him. They're not asking for anybody. And that's when he knew he made it.
Wow. Because that it was is a tough business to succeed in, and I understand why he didn't want to get you into it. Do you know the difference between a pizza and a professional musician?
Yeah. I can't remember. Go ahead.
Pizza can feed a family of four?
There you go.
Oh! son of a bitch.
Actually, on the DVD.
I was going to hold that up.
The DVD right
here. 6.5 hours of bonus material.
I'll give you another one, Denny. That. What's the definition of perfect pitch?
A dead...
When you throw a banjo in a dumpster and it doesn't hit the sides? That was for your dad and his hate of banjos.
Well, so I have an actual chapter called Musician Jokes.
Oh, okay.
Oh, that's cool.
For real?
And every time I do an interview, I have one of the guys say, you know, hey, tell me a musician joke.
And they always have one.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It was awesome.
I poached mine from Prairie Home Companion joke show.
Exactly.
You would.
Now, be prepared, too. Dick Clark's in this movie.
Dick Clark is...
Without the stroke.
Without the stroke.
So he's pre-stroke.
Pre-stroke.
Yeah. So you got these a while back.
Pre-stroking Dick.
Because I went...
Honestly.
Thank you. Good night.
other than the DVD, this can be found streaming on Netflix, so it's right there.
But we don't want to watch it there, though.
You will not get the 6.5 hours of extra fun stuff.
We're talking about, like,
there's two discs.
The holiday.
Uh-huh.
You know what I'm saying? Holiday's coming up. We might sell out.
You can't open a package of downloadable
I
video.
I have Leon Russell fans in my family that are going to have to get this for Christmas,
There's a great Leon Russell outtake, actually.
Is there?
Yeah. Leon Russell looks super cool. Wait till you see
him. He does look cool.
It's crazy.
And Leon didn't want to do the interview for many years. I didn't get him till he's awesome.
Yeah.
And I didn't get it till the last year. Last year before we actually had to cut it. Or in 2000. See, we didn't release this.
Because this is like a 10-year or more project, right?
The story behind it was I could not get the money to raise to pay off all the music. So I kept going.
Of course,
so
I was
going
to ask that.
There's 110 songs. So I kept doing credit card, refi, and got to the point where, okay, we've gone as far as we can. We made the film. 2008, we got a lot of awards, but no one would touch us because it was like,
the budget must have been mostly music. These are all huge songs.
And then
right?
you got the union, which is another $200,000 went to the union. You got stock footage. You got all this stuff. I had to pay that later.
We were talking to another documentarian a couple of weeks ago, and he had mentioned that there had been some revelations and changes in fair use laws. Were you able to benefit from any of those?
Not in the music. Because here's the thing is, there could be some fair use in this, but here's the thing. There's only three labels. Am I going to bust their balls over one song to save a few bucks when they got 10 others and they're going to go, uh-uh.
Yeah.
You dealing with Universal?
All of them.
Yeah.
Well, Universal, Sony, and what was it?
Warner Brothers?
Yeah.
Those are the Warner Chapel.
Well, let's get to. I asked your favorite song, played by your dad. But what is your favorite movie of all time?
Diner.
Oh,
there's a new one.
That's a new one. What is it that you like about Diner?
Yeah. I just love
the food.
Dialogue. Yeah. I just love. There's something.
Yeah, right.
It's funny because that's kind of what my film I based the round table with. Is them always talking. And musicians jab each other.
That's how Denny interviews the members of the Wrecking Crew.
Yeah, it's great because they give Carol shit. She's like, tell them the story about, and then she tells the whole story, and they're like, well, you just told the story.
That's a great perspective on this movie, actually.
But it's interesting because Barry Levinson, instead of letting them, he would let them talk over each other instead of, you know, usually as an actor, you guys all know, don't cut off his line. Yeah. And it was the opposite.
It was like Robert Altman style, right?
Yeah. And I just think that's the greatest.
Yeah, you know, so it's very lifelike.
Did Levinson write that too? He wrote that, didn't he?
And
so Levinson directed Rock the Kasbah. So there you go. It's all.
Oh, did he?
Did
he
really?
That's a Levinson movie. Wow. Oh my God! And Brain Man, and he's a
It's
a Cinderella story.
Right? Cinderella story. Hey, and his dad played on Caddyshack.
That was my second favorite.
How cool is that?
That is very cool.
My wife hates that film. If I would have known before, I married her.
Right? It's a deal breaker.
Things could have gone differently.
Does he play on more than the afternoon delight kind of scene
not in that one.
Not in Caddyshack.
That was because Kenny Loggins asked him to come in on that.
Oh, very cool. Scene.
He was just called in. Yeah, he's not doing the other stuff. But he did all, I mean, he did over close to 1,000 films and TV.
Oh. Yeah.
You know, you go, it's crazy.
I'm just going to throw this out there because, you know, that's how I roll, but he didn't happen to play on Ghostbusters, did he?
No.
Oh,
sorry.
Now, there
all right,
is,
good to know.
There
all
is right. a track, and I've never been sure if it was a library track or if someone actually played it for real on Caddyshack, is when they all, it's when they're going to christen the ship, and there's that sort of like active by the beach sort of did it. Everybody's, everything's kind of going on, and it's the best, man. I got it from a Negro, like that scene.
That's so funny.
I like to think that he played on that.
I'll go with it if it makes you feel better.
probably a library track.
I've decided he's played on Ghostbusters. He just doesn't know it. So.
Yeah, him and Ray Parker Jr.
Yes.
We have to blow through this.
What did you see this week?
Is that your cousin?
I could talk.
Your brother?
I could talk music for 100 years.
Who knows who that is? That's Paul.
But we need to get on to what you see this week. But let's keep it real brief. I saw Everest with MoviePass.
Oh, how is it in 3D?
I didn't see it in 3D.
I saw it
in 2D.
Well, that's probably good.
With the MoviePass
in 3D.
Well, the walk in 3D would mess you
up. Can't wait.
Yeah, that the last half hour of that movie, I was shaking.
Did you like Everest?
It was good. I liked it. There's pedigree all over it. It's full of good actors, but it kind of is procedural. Mm. Here's stuff that happened, and it's over.
Did you see the doc?
It looks procedural.
I didn't see the doc, but I saw a documentary about climbing Everest that was like in one of those IMAX
education. Oh, you know, I'm so sorry. I'm off on a different...
Man on Wire?
I'm thinking of Man on Wire.
I did say the walk real quick. He loved that.
The walk was really good.
He saw that documentary and loved it because he thought that Philippe was so full of life and energy and enthusiasm. But
that's a good documentary. Yeah. They got that one right, I think, when they gave it the Oscar. Oh, you produced the Oscars, didn't you?
Yeah, it sounds great on camera. I produced.
IMDb says so.
Yes. I produced the opening of Billy Crystal's in 2000.
Oh, wow.
Okay, that is probably one of the greatest Oscar openings ever, though. Everybody always talks about that.
That was the one that they came back. They'd done the first two where they, 2 years before, couple years before. Billy walked away, and then they asked him to come back, and that was the 50th. What was the anniversary? 75th anniversary.
Oh my God! Everyone loves when he does
that. Yeah, it was great.
Especially did you help produce the montage, the song?
Yeah, we did the montage of we shot all the montage.
Very
stuff.
Cool.
It was hell.
Oh,
that's where you stick him into the movies, right? You put him in American Beauty.
That's awesome.
He's amazing. Yeah, it was pretty.
It must have been tough pre-digital.
I didn't even think about that.
Yeah.
Wow. No, we were shooting film. I mean. It's pretty amazing the technicians on that. I mean, you have Dan Butts was the art director, and he nailed it every time.
Wow!
Yeah. But it was hell. It was a hell job.
Hmm.
Yeah. Well, we're happy you had that hell job.
We'll take it for the label, I guess. Yeah. Hey, Oscars!
What else did anyone see?
I saw a couple of things.
TBS Report.
TBS Report had Pacific Rim, and I don't know, I didn't notice it the first time, but there are stretches of that movie, minute after minute, in which there are neither giant robots or giant Godzillas. Didn't realize it the first time.
Right.
Oh my God, there's a lot of non-Godzilla, non-robot stuff.
Yeah.
It really tries to develop
If you want to see robots, go
yeah,
see Gem.
I need giant robots and giant Godzillas. But I saw Rocky V.
Did you?
And you,
great concept.
I'm pointing at you, Paul, because you said you like this movie?
Rocky Balboa.
Oh, okay.
I'm the one that liked Rocky V, but in concept only. The fact that it is the next logical step for that story is good. It is a 90s movie. It cannot avoid it.
The 90s sucked all these good movies
and made him whatever they
he's
are.
He's insufferable as the punch-drunk Rocky. It's just the hardest thing to watch.
So you suffered through it because you thought he liked it.
I kept watching it going, what? Okay, Paul sees something
have
here.
Have you not seen Rocky Balboa?
I have not.
Oh, you have to see
okay.
it. That's quite excellent.
See it for Creed.
Okay.
Oh, poor guy.
But I'm watching the whole movie going, what is Paul seeing here? Okay, another 20 minutes. Another 20 minutes.
But do a ramp up. See Rocky Balboa. You got a month to, and then Creed comes out where he coaches Creed.
All right, I'll do that.
And what else did anybody see?
Very briefly, now this has been a couple weeks since I saw a movie, actually, because I've been very, very busy. But I thought of you, Karen.
Oh.
Because Quentin Tarantino at the New Beverly Theater showed Alien.
Oh, okay. Oh.
That's not why I thought of you.
Oh.
Alien and something called Forbidden
Planet
something.
Planet Terror. It's the Grindhouse one.
But just call it Planet Terror.
Sure.
But double feature. And so, of course, seeing Alien in the theater. I mean, my goodness. And the Martian's in theater right now. To see the actual Alien in real time is wonderful. But you know what they show before it? Because they always show a cartoon and a trailer show before the movies at the New Beverly.
Gem. Here
not
we go.
Gem. He actually showed Ray Parker Jr.'s actual Ghostbusters video with 200 people in attendance who are laughing. This video is so absurd.
Oh, well, the actors show up, right?
Yeah.
It's got John Candy
and
in
they
it.
Dance?
It's got
the Ghostbusters
and,
dance.
And, yes, and Bill Murray does the tries to break dance in Times Square, and they grab his feet and try and turn him around and do a backspin or whatever, because that is very popular at that time. Is the breakdancing?
Oh, I love it.
It was just a wonderful flashback to Ghostbusters. That's what videos looked like at that time. That movie may be a bit timeless, except for a couple special effects, but that's what music videos looked like at that time.
If you like Ghostbusters, that song, then you're gonna love the Boubet Sisters show. We're performing on Halloween from 7:30 to 8:30, and that's our encore. So we're coming back with
at the Cork Lounge in Sherman Oaks.
Yes.
7:30.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I just saw Shelter, which is the Paul Bettany movie. Did Shelter, you hear about that
I don't
one?
Know this one.
He, Paul Bettany, the actor, just directed
Vision
this
from the Avengers.
Exactly. Among others.
Exactly. So he did. He directed and wrote this film about two homeless people, and Jennifer Connelly, his wife, stars as a heroin addict, homeless person. It's really beautiful. I mean, it's really harsh and touching, but. It's a beautiful
good script. Debut directorial wise.
Yeah, he didn't act. He just
he didn't direct at all.
Oh, he directed
I thought the two of them would have been the couple.
No, he kept it. He said, you know, would he say it was directing Jennifer was like taking a rock with showers or something, or a shower with rocks. You know, can you imagine directing your loved one
through heroin addiction?
Yeah. She's amazing in it. In this, and he's
they were married. Are they married?
Yep.
Yeah.
But we learned tonight that Nancy Sinatra
is not married
to Don Randy. Good to know.
And that Don Ramsey is no longer married.
But seriously, get the Apple Music
at
trial.
All. Thank you, Karen.
Nancy Sinatra, hit shuffle.
Okay, let's get to the big grand finale of every show. Karen's look at the birthdays of those who make the movies. It's Karen's birthdays. Take it away.
All right, let's start off our week of birthdays by wishing a very happy birthday to Miss Carrie Fisher.
Oh!
Yes, she turns. Are you ready? Is everybody sitting down?
Yep. How old is she?
59.
Star Wars week.
Wow.
59, people.
59 is almost 60.
Shush, don't even think about it. But she can play anywhere from smirking to sarcastic. Now, we all know Miss Fisher from her work in Star Wars, The Empire Strikes Back, and Return of the Jedi. Of course. But this December, she will reprise her role as Princess Leia in Star Wars Episode 7, The Force Awakens.
Is she in this new trailer?
Yeah.
Oh,
briefly.
Christ,
looks fantastic.
Doesn't have a line, but
can't
she's
even handle it.
This is kind of cute. According to IMDb, when asked about her reaction to the sale of Lucasfilm to Disney, she said, "I am now a Disney princess."
Ah, a slave princess.
Exactly. Carrie is not just an iconic actress, but she's also a well-respected script doctor, the person who's hired to punch up a number of Hollywood scripts.
Mm-hmm. So says the internet?
So says IMDb of all internets.
I didn't know she was a script doctor.
Get this. She has punched up such scripts as Milk Money, The River Wild, Sister Act, The Mirror Has Two Faces, Outbreak, Intolerable Cruelty, and, pay attention, she has punched up Star Wars Episode 1, The Phantom Menace, Star Wars Episode 2, Attack of the Clones, and Star Wars Episode 3, Revenge of the Sith.
She needs to punch harder.
She needs to work a little bit harder.
She needs to outright slug.
So I'm not saying we need to
blame
her.
She's a writer of Milk Money.
But she And this is
okay. Now it makes sense.
You mean that masterpiece?
These are just a couple of the movies she's worked on. It's kind of crazy that she has punched up tons of stuff.
Postcards to the Edge.
Yeah.
So next up, let's wish a very happy birthday to Mr. Christopher Lloyd. He turned
Great Scott! Wow.
Right?
Great Scott.
And
today's the day to do so.
Today is his actual birthday.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
No way.
I wonder if they picked this day because of him. I don't know.
Because it is Back to the Future
it
Day.
It is
today,
Back
right?
to the Future Day.
This is the day in 2015 that Marty McFly goes
This is
back
the,
to the future.
Day that Doc Brown from Back to the Future movies, he was sent Marty Back to the Future to October 21st, 2015.
And what a mind trip for our listeners, because when they actually hear the show, it will be in the future.
Yeah.
So it's not actually going to be Back to the Future
and
Day when they hear it.
All of the events in all of the Back to the Future movies will be in the past.
In the, there
what?
You go.
So
mind blown.
I'm sure you guys have heard this a lot on the interwebs and whatnot today, that there's a couple of things that Back to the Future predicted, and we're just wondering how close were they. For example, hoverboards. There is a California architect, Greg Henderson, who designed a similar board that floats in midair called the Hendo hoverboard. Did you hear about that?
Yes.
Yeah, so
Tony Hawk rode that around.
Oh. Okay.
Flying cars. People have played around with that idea of a
Never
flying
Never
going to
happen.
Car.
Did your father ever work with Marvin Berry?
No.
Is he the guy who sang
That's Chuck Berry's
Chuck
brother.
Berry's
yeah,
brother?
Back of the future.
Hey, it's your brother, Marvin.
Friend of the show, Harry Waters Jr.
The kids are going to love this.
You know that new sound you're looking for?
Also, Marty's daughter That's in funny. The movie, she wears a headband that makes phone calls that are a lot like Google Glass.
Oh, yes.
Which is kind of
And
crazy.
Nothing else in their 2015 is anything like ours.
No.
The fashion is absolutely people from 1989 saying, what would the future be like?
Well, we know for a
Everything
fact.
Everything would be holograms.
We know for a fact that they were wrong because today we found out the Cubs did not win the World Series. Yeah.
But what a great flirtation.
Amazing.
I mean, it's a very movie guy week.
One of the things I love about Back to the Future 2 that they did get right, but they had the idea right, but the wrong technology, is that everyone's going to have a bunch of TVs, except for they were all the picture tube TVs.
There
were like 12 picture tube TVs mounted on the wall, taking up half your home.
All right.
Self-lacing shoes, I'm proud to say we are not that lazy. I'll lace my own.
All right, and lastly, because you can't go without wishing Mr. Weird Al Yankovic a happy
I just
birthday.
Saw him in concert. My God. My God, he's a genius.
I heard it's a great concert.
He is absolutely... There is no better place to be happy on earth
yes.
than a Weird Al concert. If you were sad, there is one recipe.
Weird Al.
Lay down that money.
Well, he turned 56, so I just think he's fantastic. He can play anywhere from Madonna to Michael Jackson.
Oh, my God.
According to IMDb, and I think this is kind of interesting, Weird Al was the subject of a 1999 episode of VH1's Behind the Music, and it was a documentary. Unlike other such celebrity documentaries in the series, he did not include any mention of alcoholism, drug abuse, divorce, gambling, religious cults, or sexual escapades.
Well, there you go.
I did see that one, and he had a great comment about how people would come up to him and say, well, where have you been? What have you been doing? He's like, I'm still doing the same thing I've always done.
30 years of dominance in your genre. It's crazy. Yeah.
The only game in that town.
Yeah.
The only game
Weird
in
Al.
Parody music.
Yeah.
Weird Al?
Yeah.
His mucus.
His mucus.
Wow.
Oh, Weird Al's writing that down.
He totally loves that. His music has appeared in such films as Spy Hard, UHF, the Transformers movie, and he's acted in The Naked Gun 2.5, and UHF. It seems that he and Leslie Nielsen have a lot of similar things on their resumes. Oddly enough, you wouldn't put those two together.
No.
But a lot of the same movies and TV. So now, Bart, you know how much I love when celebrities sing.
This is true. Denny, I don't know if this happens to you a lot, but people come up to me all the time and they say, tell me two interesting things about Karen Volpe. And I say,
well, what do you say?
She loves Bill Murray, but you knew that.
Figure that one out.
And then I tell them, she loves when celebrities sing.
Love and that. I do. I especially love when birthday boys sing. So I thought, why not tie it all together? And now we're not going to have Bill Murray sing Star Wars, which would be amazing. But instead, I thought, why don't we have Weird Al sing a little Yoda for us?
Oh, God.
Take it away.
This is so good.
Internet.
I will go to karaoke bars and I will play Lola, but I'll sing this.
Ah! I love it!
Oh, my God.
His lyrics are genius.
I saw the little wren sitting there on a log.
If your dad played with Weird Al, Denny, that would be over the top.
They would have gotten along really well.
Your dad was a cut-up, man.
By the way,
from the movie.
I've sometimes said I was born at exactly the right time to enjoy VHS, to enjoy Star Wars. This Weird Al in 3D comes out in, what, 83, 84?
Something like that, yeah.
When you hear Eat It for the first time, yep, and you are, I don't know, whatever, eight, the perfect age, whatever the perfect age is to hear Eat It and go, someone took the most famous song in the world and did weird lyrics to it, yep, and they're all great? That's crazy.
Now, before we wrap up birthdays, I also just want to just throw one off the cuff for the great Mike Nichols, the Phantom Editor, is having a birthday this
Phantom
weekend.
Phantom Editor.
Yes, friend of the show.
Friend of the show. So I just want to say happy birthday, Mike.
And that wraps up another movie showcast. Together we're the movie guys. Individually we are.
Karen,
Bart Guys with his new hat.
You can all follow us on Twitter at The Movie Guys for daily jokes and links. Nice. Also, Facebook.com/The Movie Guys, iTunes, Vimeo, YouTube, Funny or Die, SoundCloud, Vine, Instagram, LinkedIn, all that shit. Thanks to Denny Tedesco.
Yay. Thank you, Denny. Guys.
Awesome. And also, everybody, we're wearing some super cool The Wrecking Crew hats, so check that out when you want to.
I'm going to steal this DVD.
See them.
I want a DVD,
YouTube.
Denny.
WreckingCrew.tv.
I think we got a look. I got to get you one.
All right.
Do you go out to any of these screenings? I don't know. It's.
I do.
Yeah. Because I know it's playing all over the country still to the end of November at least.
Yeah,
here and there.
I'm going to Nashville Monday.
That's a whole nother slew of studio musicians.
I'm
going to
read
there.
Off all the people that are listed on the front here: the Beach Boys, Nat King Cole, Elvis, Dean Martin, the Mamas and the Papas, Phil Spector, Glenn Campbell, the Monkees, Ike and Tina Turner, Henry Mancini, Frank Sinatra, the Byrds, the Righteous Brothers, Sonny and Cher, Simon and Garfunkel, Nancy Sinatra, Shelley.
Right. Spoiler alert: the Monkees clips in the movie might be one of those instances where the band didn't play their own music.
Well, yeah, spoiler alert.
And don't forget, we're at the Ghostbusters screening at the UME Credit Union in Burbank this Friday the 23rd to get there about 6:30 for pre-show weirdness.
Ghostbusters.
Thanks to Steve Scholes for his writing contributions to the show every week, and as always, we owe everything to Pat
Peach.
Next week, Karen, Happy Month continues because there's also a new Sandra Bullock movie. Our brand is Crisis. We'll talk about that.
A bit of a letdown after Bill Murray.
We'll talk about that and more. We'll see you then. Thanks, Danny.
Bye, guys.
Bartell, I'm old and gray.
Ooh, prophetic.
I had to sign, so they'll be making me more.